Welcome to Lansing Online News Radio. This is WLNZ 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan, LCC Radio. This is Bonnie Buckaroo, and I am joined by my co-host, Bill Castanier. Welcome, Bill. I guess you have an announcement to make on our first off the bus. We have something coming up at the Eastwood Shores?
Yes, I do. A local artist, Lisa Starr, was distinguished enough to illustrate a new book never published before by James Brooks, Cats of Cooking. And he introduced it at Eastwood Shores at 7 p.m. Eastwood Shores. It's a very fun
day.
Very fun day. PC is going to be that worldwide list. It's going to be published on this every time. James Brooks.
Sort of
oh, this is amazing. When they have a date, what other author has a date for?
Yeah.
Wednesday, which is June 16th. Every year they celebrate Ulysses. June 16th is the day of the first year of life. And Ulysses takes place 1 year ago.
Yeah.
So it's a great deal of life. Very difficult.
Yeah, I had a friend
who said he liked my tea, and I knew that they had my tea. And I said, oh, I would like that. I said, who are the authors? And he said, oh, no, I don't know. And I thought, people do that. I see people do that. They'll sit and answer. I know, all the way through. Just amazing. Casey told me he's very good for 2 weeks. 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's exotic.
It is an exotic. And it's not a human picture.
I still like to very much when I read a lot of these stories. It's just beautiful. It's just really, I mean, there's something about that. It's poetry, really.
And, you know, part of James Joyce's attraction is friendship. It's not hard.
Sure.
It's hard.
They grow fast. 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 They another time. And then that third one gets moved. And I took him another time to work with him. And I said, make your genitalia never fail you.
And my mother, what?
A little rhyming scheme.
You're 15, you're reading what? So, I'll never forget talking to Tinker for that reason. Got me into a little hot water with mom.
I used to read those books. My star was a
babysitter. Oh,
he had a book. So I didn't have to do it.
Oh.
So babysat a lot.
And he was smart enough to make 15 minutes.
Apparently he was just smart enough not to get caught.
Yeah, no, I was doing my babysitting there.
Yeah. Well, we are joined by another author tonight. Now, Casey is going to be at Eastwood Shoes from 7 onward on Thursday night. But we have your evening planned for you, because before that, you're going to go through Everybody Reads at 5 o'clock, right? Where Jesse Goldberg Strasser is going to be introducing his new book. And you're going to tell us a little about that?
Well, Jesse, first of all, people probably read the wife of Elaine Jean Rogers. And he was one of those guys you might want to call a baseball player. And he's taken it to a higher level. He's put together a baseball thesaurus called the Words Elaine Jean Rogers.
That would be every word related to baseball. Things like inning, I would need to explain to
you. Okay, well, one of the things you're going to have to know. That's the new book. Some of the baseball books are very good. Tell us about your new book and why you checked it.
Well, it's like with your friend, with the amateur team, Stuart and Tim James Dorsey. This is my annotated baseball because the language is what fascinates me. There's all of this research now and all of the studies about statistical analysis and I prefer the stories. So back in 2005, when I first broke into baseball, I discovered that I was saying all the same words, and there were so many more words. I noticed that this baseball thesaurus just erupted over these seasons.
there hasn't been a book like this.
If there was, I would have bought it and never bothered writing it. No. There was a Paul Dixon wrote the baseball dictionary. I asked him for his blessing before writing this one, because he had been the authoritative voice on baseball reference books. But no, I was looking for any but all of the different slang terms for home run, for example, or bagger, a dinger, leader, a round tripper, and there was nothing for the sport. I just list to them, and then said, why are some of these terms used?
You have like Esther's, well, you seem to make up its own words for everything.
I give Ernie some special places in the book. There's definitely a space reserved for Ernie. For example, when the batter is caught in the stood there like a house by the side of the road, one of the things he had said in relation to the poem. So absolutely, there's famous voice has to say that voice gets a spot.
That's pretty amazing. Now, come on, you quite some time.
Oh my goodness, if you saw my walk-in closet in my apartment, all right, so all of the clothes are hung up on the corners, but above on the shelf, it is just, it's half of the baseball books, all the different research going from book after book, to see what else I can find, all of the different terms that I can use. So 2005 was the genesis, but it really got going in 2009, 2010. I'd be sitting on the bus as we took the road trip out to rural Iowa for the Lugnuts' next game, and I'd be taking away.
So did your players look with you on this? Did they think it was fun?
They leaned over my shoulder to figure out what I was so engrossed with at first, but yes, they started volunteering all the different rules they had heard and go through it. And sometimes they said, oh, that's a good one, I hadn't heard that in a while. And sometimes I was introducing them to stuff because baseball is such back in the 19th century and saying, no, this was the term used in the 1870s and 1880s, and this was what was used in the 1920s, and so now they start tossing those words around the clubhouse. It's that whole grand vocabulary, it's its own jargon.
Why do you think it is? It's probably more than any other sport.
Is it because it's talking? Is it talking? Because football is game planned, and it's the whole George Carlin routine of the field general and trying to figure out the play. Basketball, you just go out and shoot some things. But baseball is talk. Baseball is a sport of conversation and a sport of leisure. And when it's had all of these decades, and it's a sport that has appealed to all sorts of different members of society, it doesn't matter who you are, whether you're upper crust, literati, or whether you're someone just sitting back in the countryside relaxing or doing it, you talk more than anything else. And language evolves from that conversational tone and from people talking back and forth. That's how language evolves.
Tell us some of your favorite.
Oh, man. Well, every year there's a new term that just starts meaning something to me. For example, the boomerang ball, which you can picture vividly. It's when the pitcher throws a pitch, and the batter hits it, and it comes whipping right back at the pitcher. It's as if he threw a boomerang. So, in that sense, that term took over for one season, 1 year. There's also the idea of a worm burner. Well, it's a hot ground ball that smokes along through the glass, in the grass, and sizzles its way, and if any worm gets in the way, we'll retire.
So this might go back to people like what, Ring Lardner?
And even before, we're talking, Henry Chadwick is considered the very first baseball scribe. But from him, yes, Ring Lardner, Grantham, Rice, and all of these folks who applied their own poetic instincts to the game.
Ring Lardner wrote a poem about Major Baseball, Chris Sella. Why is the uniform always black?
What that story gives rise to is there started a game called Any Player Will Hustle the Lot and Dirty Up His Jersey. Was considered a dirtbag, and it was considered a compliment. If you're a dirtbag, you're someone who tries hard. And there's a college out on the West Coast, Long Beach State University, California, where every single other athletic member of Long Beach State, they're the 49ers, but the baseball team are known as the Dirtbags.
That's a cool name. I don't know, you know, you might
might have some interesting discussion off the field about
that's right, but you take some pride in it on the field.
You probably don't sell your t-shirts as much as some others.
No. Well, that's when baseball teams started coming up, the home teams wore white because you could always do laundry at home. But on the road, you wore your darker jersey. It was a road race. You never wore quite a shirt of being able to do laundry away.
Now, did our friend Peter Morris, who's a baseball historian from Hazlitt, help you with any of this?
He wrote the foreword. I was very graced and honored by him. He wrote what I think is perhaps one of the greatest baseball books in my opinion of all time. Being the inches, describing the origins of how everything came to pass, why there are dugouts, why there's a pitcher's mound. So we get together and we simply talk baseball. And our conversations are real simple. I'd say to Peter, this, the rosin bag. Why does baseball have a rosin bag? And Peter would say to me, oh, here it is. And then he'd look, because I'm now meshed in the game currently, he'd say, why did the Blue Jays make this trade?
No, I love it. When you go on the road in the spring, do some book signings?
Yes, that's my hope. So it's all starting this Thursday at 5 o'clock that everybody reads. And then it's my hope because I travel with the team. Wherever they go, I'll be...
You'll be carrying a sample of books with you?
I suppose so, and hoping for the best. The fun thing about it is that I know why I wrote the episodes. Everybody that reads it has to find their own meaning and why they personally find it what it feels like. It always surprises me.
Now, will the Lugnuts, do you think, will they do something special when they open the season? It'll be kind of fun.
We'll see. It's a ways away right now. The Lugnuts are very busy making sure that they get tickets on sales, schedule,
not worried about Jesse in this book right now.
Oh, no, absolutely not. I'm the last to get one.
Jesse, one last thing. Could you do like just a short segment and use one or two of those words? I know I'm putting you in the spot, but I bet you can.
The Paso totals the rubber, rears back and twirls, the batsman lets fly. It sounds like I'm hitting Casey at the bat, doesn't it? And off the spheroid flew, lambasted to the deepest part of the outer garden, where crash is off the fence. You keep it going. The outer gardener picks it up and whirls it back in toward the infield. But the batter has long since arrived at the second sack, the keystone, where there he stays secure.
Thank you, Mike. Again, let's remind people.
Where can I find the book?
So, the official release is this Thursday. Right now, I know that it is available on Amazon.com and Barnes & Noble's website.
Is it downloadable for Kindle as well?
It is. The book is available. The ebook is $5.99, and the print book will be $14.
I think we're
going to
say
that.
We missed it. Thank you very much, exactly.
My pleasure.
We're going to have you back during the spring when the season is ready.
That would be wonderful.
It'd be great.
Maybe you and Peter
together. Thursday, 5 to 7, if everybody needs, Jesse will be there, and he'll have copies in his hand by then.
Sounds good.
Good. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
This is WLNZ 89.7 SEC Radio here in Lansing, Michigan. We're going to be joined now by Bass and Sarter, and also our friend and frequent contributor, Todd Haywood, who is going to be talking some politics tonight. And Bass and I ended up with an exciting night the other night, but it was a little more exciting than you planned on. I didn't even see you in the back of the room earlier. I heard your voice at a certain point when we were there Thursday night at Pace Hall, when David Horowitz, the author, came in to talk about his new book, I guess, in some ways. But he was also one in a book that was called Christians United for Israel. And he was there to talk primarily about Obama's Middle East policy. I didn't know that. I knew he was coming, and I actually thought he was going to talk about right to work.
Wow. Well, we know where your brain was.
Wrong time. Wrong
place. And I thought, well, if not that, then we might be talking about something like religious or
Ramparts.
I thought there'd be, and then he also has a group that is encouraging students to monitor liberal professors. And I had some questions that I always wanted to ask him about that. I've never seen that. He hasn't been able to encourage them in essence to make sure that the professors say anything that they think is offensive to conservative, that they should be given to him and broadcast it to him. So I showed up for that reason, and then found out he was going to talk about Israel. Originally, you asked him some questions from the audience, and it seemed that he really was thrown by them. What's about
him? Yeah, I mean, I knew that he was going to come along and spread knowledge, so I basically wanted to see what exactly he was going to say.
And he kept talking about how basically Iran and other countries were going to be easy to kill all the Jews in the world. And he was very extreme.
This is basically the attacks on people in black people. At what point is it black people in this country that do this country?
Yeah, in particular,
I think the prison industrial complex would disagree with that.
He had to spend any time in prison
with him. It was quite bizarre. He specifically went after Anthony Weiner's wife, who is the aide to Senator Hillary Clinton, and travels with her when he was. And he insisted that she was a secret Muslim Brotherhood operative who was seeking to subvert U.S. foreign policy through Hillary Clinton, which was just really odd.
Anyways, Hillary Clinton has impacted on the fact that if I had another daughter, I would have to give up to marry. This is how I truly got to her house. And it's sad that this was the one here, that was the guy that had to be in the And for the guy, I've never done a thing that on the Senate floor, we made a way back in the state, and support of MIT, sort of,
there's a small sliver of, I think, the Tea Party people that pick their shots for some reason. And it seems to me that it's fairly easily recruited, but it just keeps recruiting.
Sadly, I've been doing that from my thoughts this time.
I wasn't aware of that.
Well, I thought Mike
would.
Oh, it's just what I mean.
Okay,
I can do that.
I'm
smacked around for that. So,
ah.
Yeah, he was part of the Tea Party caucus, the original. Very nice day. Nope, oops, I'm sorry, I was wrong. Totally wrong, didn't mean it.
Well, people like David Horowitz can have been in the radio and go after that.
It's very strange. And I was, the campus conservative was when I went in. I checked later and I was surprised that he was coming over to the office to try to verify who were in the leadership of that group. And it turned out they hadn't gotten all of their people to the source, so they shouldn't have really had the leader. But then after you asked him some questions, it seemed like that sort of started to move on the path of the team. Pretty rapid.
Yeah, and he might have had to know that he got angry at the class. Yeah. He kept speaking that he would be on my team if you're a model. He was spreading this information. He said, basically, you're a form of the other. You don't know what to do. That's very confused about that.
What were the, you're asking him to take three questions.
Yeah, the first thing which I asked him was about my like I said, Senator McCain, I'm being pretty glad about this. You come here and again, it's going to work. The second thing I mentioned was about the relations by the community.
Yes.
They thought you had the source for contractors, consultants, experts on contractors. I pointed out to the audience this, the thing that when you show that you're exposed on CNN's recent paper as being a fraud, and the investigative journalism on tech, to the extent they send out reporters to actually get a view of this guy, went down and tried to find out all those things that police departments were saying. They were not able to prove any single thing that he claims not to this guy. So that was a lie. So I tried to prove it, and to that, and he said, whoa, this is a reason for libel, thinking, when you show that name, this is what
he's
doing. And he was like, that's why we had investigated the one that we got. And when they contacted me directly and asked me the questions, and to the extent that Walid Shabazz had to cut the interview by saying, I mean, CNN is not your business. You're not interested in the source of my own.
Well, it seemed that he was very litigious. He was constantly saying that if anybody was critical of him, he said it was, well, that's slander, so that's libel. So he seemed to be making all of those accusations. And I sort of followed up, and I asked him a question, because I thought there were a number of inconsistencies. Well, he's angry, he seems to be at everything,
yeah,
from all directions.
And I asked him to clarify one of those, which is, on the one hand, it seems to be coming to the President Obama was in league with terrorists and seeking to bring down the United States and turn an entrance on sort of part of the people's control. And then he also said that President Obama couldn't be trusted because he was issuing drone strikes against terrorists, and the drone strikes were causing problems for the United States, which is a position I might agree with on some things, but I'm not on the head of the drone strike. But I thought, you can't hold both positions. He's either with you or against you. He's not both, you know. And boy, it got really heated. And the irony was, then he came, I don't know if you could see in the back of the room, they came for me, right? Grabbed my camera.
I was stunned. I didn't know what's going on. I mean, I think
looking at a reality TV show.
I mean, you would think that the people in the room would react to it, but they were all supposed to be stunned and did not react spontaneously.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think they were a bit stunned to find out what was happening. Although, you know, I thought about it later, and one of the things that occurred to me was that if a student had gone up and tried to take a mic away from him, I'm sure that student would have been standing there like a hokey at the
wall.
So I was surprised that they didn't react to him. What happened was, I had gone up and talked with him before the meeting, and I had said, I'm going to be videoing, telling where you might be standing, because I'm, you know, hey, you see me in the front, well, I got there afterwards. Room so I could set up a video camera. Somebody else was setting up a video camera. I didn't know who she was. We conferred about, well, gee, that red screen's going to throw our mirrors off. So I went back up to him and I said, would it be okay if I put this up? Are you going to have PowerPoint slides? So he perfectly well knew that I was video. And then all of a sudden, when he was unhappy with my question, he spun on me and said, is that a video camera? What are you doing with a video camera? I have to confiscate your film. And I thought, what?
It started to get funny if you were watching it on video and not if you were there.
Yeah, no, if you were there,
your adrenaline was running.
I was actually afraid.
He's a pretty good sized guy.
No,
he isn't. I mean, he's bulky.
No.
It's just the energy is
intimidating. There are two things that make it different for me. I'm a former domestic violence victim, and when angry looking guys come at me with their hands in front of them, I get really nervous. You know, it's just one of those, it's like, yikes! Where am I going to? Right, yeah. I just, it's fight or flight, and I'm not interested in fighting. I really want to leave. And then second of all, I have a really bad revenge problem. And most people who know me know that you can't even touch me. And I was afraid that he wouldn't know that and get into a tussle, and he would really badly hurt me. And I also thought he was going to put my parents in. I didn't even wrap his hands up and he would have done it. So that's what really had me, because that's an expensive camera. And I'm sure they wanted to see that one. But it was a big joke. I mean, by the time I got out there, I didn't ask the police officer that we're sort of there, because I noticed the audience was not on my side.
No, this was a hostile territory. Mm. I left right after you. I didn't feel comfortable there.
Yeah, I thought, get out while the getting is good, and I've got a police officer watching my back. Yeah.
You know, and this gets into a long history. I mean, she was going in. These radical right-wing speakers.
Yeah.
This is not a new scenario. I mean, it sort of happens, but it's not new.
What I can understand is this guy must have lots of people challenging. He says things that are so outrageous that anytime you look at something, you know, it would be somebody
else. But it doesn't matter. He's being challenged. There's a level of lightning privilege that is just bizarre to see. Imagine you would think, just sort of on a rational level, when you see people like Chris Simcox or this guy.
He was the previous.
Yeah, he was the Minuteman.
Minuteman from Arizona.
You would think that they would recognize that what they're saying is so controversial that they're going to get you.
Right.
But instead, in their minds, what they're saying is so common sense that you're the crazy one for questioning anything they might say.
Then he called me a communist, and I said, well, actually, I'm a little further left than that.
Actually, I think you said you were a lot further left than that.
Yeah,
but
maybe
for
I did.
The video.
Yeah,
I just forgot he was a Marxist.
And so he started...
He reminded me of Alan West, who accused Obama of being a communist.
Yes, and I thought, you know, what a strange... It's like the Cold War. All of a sudden, I thought we were back in Cold War territory, where the least thing you could do was hurl the immigrants or county or something.
You know, I'm reading, and I told you I was reading a book called Subversives about the free speech in Berkeley in the 60s. Yeah. And it reads like what I saw.
Right, doesn't it?
It's very bizarre.
I thought that went out of style.
And no. It clearly has it. It's just moving on other people's feet. Yeah, I would say.
You know, I wonder, just sort of tossing an idea out there, how involved are some of these writing groups that are involved, you know, young writers who are creating makers? How are you seeing the campus?
Campus conservative.
Campus conservative is probably a group that was started by a Virginia-based.
Yes.
I can't remember what it's called.
It's involved.
Yeah. You know, and they started. Yeah. Well.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm wondering what is the relationship.
And you know, weren't you surprised that I think that others is mostly the best?
Yeah, they were adults, more seniors also.
Yes.
I guess just by my
well, you know who they were, and you weren't there, but I think that was the Sharia Long Room, the Mackinac Room downtown that was held by Representative Dave Fisherman. And they had about 300 people in the room. And many of the people on some of them were the same people who have been there. So these are people who have, there is a sort of subculture in the state that doesn't get much press coverage. If you go to LansingOnlineNews.com, you'll see some information about this, and you can go to my YouTube videos. But there's a group of Tea Partiers that are convinced that we are on the brink of having the entire United States court system come out and Sharia law about, and it's a very strange set of beliefs they have.
Well, that bill is a lot.
Yes, but no one will introduce it.
Well, no, it's been introduced. It's gotten a hearing. Actually, it's on the panel, which means that they could pull it up and put it on the House floor.
In this lame duck session? Oh, actually, that
the American Court, the American Laws for American
the
Courts.
Court.
Yeah, that bill was passed out of committee and it's now voting and it's on the panel.
Because I've been trying to keep track of it since that time, but I didn't think it was actually introduced.
It was introduced to the committee and now it's
they have to report to the capital for the day.
Are they going to run them all through the month? I mean,
well, we're
going to
talk
like
about all that fun stuff here in a minute, aren't we? So.
But tell me, in the context of sort of broader why are people so turned? Is it still ridiculous from 9/11 that they're traveling with fun?
Well, at the time of 9/11, I guess it was just here. I think that was
okay. So it's getting worse.
Yeah, it's getting worse. After 10 years, I think it's getting worse.
Interesting. Because he drew a fairly large audience. I mean, the room was slated for 60, and they had brought the two police officers there because they wanted to make sure that they didn't violate fire code. They actually employed it because it was something that people expected a lot of. But there were very few students in the audience, and it doesn't seem to see it. Does he really have a problem?
I don't think
yes. One of the students came with a private individual and talked with him, and one of them were lying here saying some of the things he was telling. And it was really unfortunate, but it was clear. I mean, I'm a free speech absolutist, and I want to see contributions to speakers come, but I can think of so many other people that really could have had a reasonable dialogue about a difference of opinion, and people would have walked away illuminated about something. This really, I mean, he didn't seem to really respond to your questions. He mostly sputtered.
Yeah.
Grandiosity. Very strange, although he's going to be able to send them and take a look at any which of the two of them, but that seems to be his style. Well, what's next on the agenda for this group, the people in that audience?
What I had in mind, they hope they can also get an investment for this,
we talked to me on the hall about that there, I believe.
Did you hear that?
Because there's nobody else on campus getting assaulted like Bonnie Buckaroo.
Exactly. It was an assault. You know, many people have suggested that we were in terms of
social resources. But my reluctance to do so comes from the life of the group and the state of justice who is trying to do this to plug in their phone and then try to prepare the phone. And I'm hopeful that we get students to come and talk to their guys and tell them. Because I really think that the group owes me an apology. I came in and good faith and knew I was doing it and pretended that somehow this was a surprise to me and that somehow I was violating civil rights and dignity, even though other people in the room were taking video and cell phones and recorders and all sorts of things. I just thought it was so strange, but I think if somebody does something like that, they really have an obligation to apologize. And it was really interesting to myself.
See, and I think the university has an obligation to say something to someone because they have to. That's both sides of that.
Sure.
Yeah.
Except you know what they're going to say?
It's a
matter of principle. You need
value. Well, I don't mind him talking.
And no, you know, it's a matter of principle. We don't know anything about that. We don't know anything about the operation. It's not what we need to say. This is a matter of because that's all we're going to say about anything. Maybe they're thinking about inflation.
You could have been.
I think I might have been around that circle a couple of times.
I think maybe so. You don't spoke to so with the young Americans for free, don't you?
More times than I could. Yeah. Yeah.
I still have to go to Ohio. What's up with Kyle?
Ohio return.
Ohio return.
In Lincoln.
Yeah. You will someday return that.
I'm 99.9% sure.
Yeah, he was the one who was waiting for instigating that number actually doing an inspection. And that problem of pain is really ferocious, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, the entire agenda is in progress, but we did this year, but yeah,
they did? All of them were the same?
All the big ones decided to do
that. So, does that mean that they're, in some ways, are going to be harder to watch?
That's part of the
issue, yeah. That's the only danger, isn't it? You're listening to WLNZ and CC Radio here in the LCC talking with Dawson Sarter about our exciting Tuesday night going to Michigan State University and Bay of Coral recently to talk about living in foreign policy. Did you really end up with any kind of commitment to work in this event?
No, I just think he was working with
Well, thank you for joining us, and I look forward to seeing you at one of the next meetings. Sometimes we train so that we can go down and read videos and other companies for people to know. I think next time we'll see each other.
Probably a wise choice.
Probably a wise
I learned choice. The buddy system is a good thing, and I was not very fast.
Yes, it's true. But that sort of is a good segue to our next discussion, which is the upcoming lame duck session here in Michigan. And the lack of bills that we just go in, giving people legislation right to work is top of the list. It's the reason that they make as many as 10,000 people this year at the Capitol tomorrow. All of a sudden, we're seeing streets closed down and nights are short, forced by the city police, and there's a couple of people in there, and there's 20 officers on each floor. And I'm standing in the U.S. out in front of everybody's officers. They're in the barricades by the side. They were injured. CNN was the first truck I saw here. They're sending up against major media and national because of the government's decision to really go back on the board. And they've said for a long time that right to work was not on the agenda. But I'm seeing fast-tracked people have any discussion for me. Todd, what's your take? Do you think this works for the North?
Well, yeah, I mean, and Democrats have actually pretty much said, look, we're done. There's no way we can stop this. All we can do is make a louder stink about it. And they're right. They don't have the votes to go and make. And that's where it's going to go through the House and it's going to end up on the government.
Well, the Michigan delegation, Carl Lawrence, that was going on the but they also got Mason Carter and all sorts of other, maybe John Conner. They went to and talked with the government this year. And they told him that, I think, the correct vote was quite important. I mean, this is
He keeps saying it isn't divisive, it's a conversation.
Which is ironic, considering 2 weeks ago he said that it wasn't on the agenda because it was too divisive for the state of Michigan. So, you know, there's some pretty nasty name calling starting to well up from both sides.
Yeah.
People are very angry, and they're angry on both sides. And I think we need to keep that in mind. And I'm not sure why the Republicans are angry, and why the Americans are angry. They're getting what they want.
They're mostly angry all the time.
But yes, but for some reason it's actually boiling out this time.
I mean, they're being paid for time. They really
if you go to Lancet Online News, you'll see the video of the Light on the Capitol steps with some gentlemen in orange t-shirts wearing the Freedom to Work banner. And they're really trying to pick a fight. I don't know why they were trying to do this, but and what really bothered me was that the mainstream media had such a good view of covering all of that, as if that is somehow an important discussion. Maybe that was the point.
Well, I think that is part of the point for PR strategy.
Yeah.
You can say, oh, look at the union clubs. That's part of what's going on.
They want
the fight. They want the battle to happen. They try to do that during the Tea Party stuff. Do you remember any group that comes to kind of protest? They try to call them Joan. I won't call her what we call her out the air. Joan Fabiana.
Yeah.
You know, she would come down whenever there was any sort of liberal event going on, and she'd play her little American anthem, and if you came anywhere near her, she'd scream, you're assaulting me, in order to try and get attention. And I think that is a tactic that works. And unfortunately, I think what's happening now is that there is so much anger, as well as so much tension, that we're really setting up a potential for real problems.
Well, you had talked with Father Peter Berry, the head of the Michigan Peace Camp, and
did.
He was saying that really, unfortunately, this show of force that apparently the governor thinks is developing is actually being
wrong. It's an instigation to that. And what we're talking about is, I mean, you talked about all the officers that were walking around in the park, and you didn't mention that they're all walking around with gas masks. Which is an indication of tear gas. They're all walking around with brand new batons.
Yeah.
Which is a violent incident. There were photos that were released out of Capitol today of stacks of riot guns in some of the offices and around the city, with kids who are going through the tours.
I saw them. They were there watching.
Yes. So there's a message being sent. And that message, you know, depending on which side you're on, is union thugs keep your control, or for the union folks who are coming in, it's a don't speak too loud anymore. And you can't have both of those exist and then have these
things. You've identified them as the bad guys. And
Peter Doherty says, you know, whenever you have this militarization of the police, you lose the respect. And I think that's absolutely true. You know, we do have on the upside, it's going to be where it's pretty much chilly tomorrow. So it's not going to be too long. You can see it's some very large protests.
We had union protests all summer long because of collective bargaining bills that were going to be made for.
Actually, that was in the spring, in March.
Yeah.
You know, it's our main government.
But the weather was still nice.
Yeah, but.
But I mean, but there's a totally different atmosphere
now. And I think part of that, too, is, you know, what's driving this is also Gwinnett. You know, the governor has made it very clear, it's part of the reason why he decided to say, okay, it's on the agenda, because of the vote. He said, you know, I went to these meetings, I asked him, don't put it on the ballot. Don't push this.
I really do.
Oh,
I
think you're right. But
I think
what
he's using it as an excuse. I wrote a piece for Lancet Online News on Sunday, and I said, when you watch Governor Snyder, what we really want to do is what Mitt Romney's agenda would have been.
Absolutely.
It's that, oh, I'm the private person in the business that I trust me, I'll come in, I'm going to focus on his jobs. You don't have to do that. So the right stuff, I'm not going to agitate, I'm going to collaborate, I'm going to compromise. No, they're not. They have an agenda, and now it's time. And this lame duck, he knows this lame duck is his best chance to get everything through. And everything's rattling through.
And this lame duck is really his only chance to get right through.
You think it could be stopped, where they would have enough votes to be able to stop it after the general?
Yeah, in fact, there's a LCIO.
I saw that in Alabama.
Passing around analysis that I think is actually pretty accurate.
It's hard to tell which votes might go. It is close.
I think they would lose by 3 votes.
Okay.
I mean, it was a close vote to begin with, which is also really interesting. They got a pretty significant majority in the House. They should have been able to pull their entire group over, and instead they lost 13 or so of their own party members, which says to me that they're not, that their party isn't going to be inside. Now, that may have been the way that it was done. I mean, let's be honest. This is, since I started covering the state legislature in 1990, this is the first time I've ever seen them introduce a bill and pass it in both chambers without hearing this. We don't even need to go to the doors locked, right? Because I've never ever seen them lock the doors during an open session like that. Not for as long as they
did.
Well, and I don't think that's necessarily accurate either. I do know that there have been other times where they've been voted and did get locked during the contentious school's battles and if I remember correctly, there were some instances where the budget battles where the doors got locked. But these were temporary. These weren't hours and hours and hours we were going to get a quarter to get it open back up. And then the legislature said, well, we're going to take our time to evaluate and make sure this is an accurate order. You know what? You got an order from a court. Open the damn door. And they just wouldn't do that. And that's, I think that's what the bigger issue
is. It's this anti-democratic This is clearly what happens when you get one for a year.
Absolutely.
And that's worth a reminder.
What's the program?
Well,
what are going to be some of the key points?
The unions at 8:30 in the morning are going to the Lansing Center where they will be in their lunch, and bank tests to take them down to the Capitol. Realistically, it's going to take them around to the building, so even though that's a relatively short distance, I don't think it's going to put everybody out of touch and say, if you plan to be there, get your budget. Because that's when really the events will start. My husband is going to be playing a couple of steps at that time, provided that he can go through, and it's going to be difficult to get there. Some of the major street people, the media and bosses are going to go out there. So a lot of people are being forced to park out here and take a couple of buses and they're doing the best that they can. And then the real challenge is that this has overshadowed in some ways, and I'm going to do this with these guys, and I really have. But there is an agenda of other bills that are going through.
Isn't there going to be another organization that's over?
Well, technically, they have a conservative group has reserved the capital steps for all those, so they technically have the steps. Now, does that mean they're going to try to claim them? I don't think they will, but.
Oh, Bonnie, you are so right.
You think the same orange shirt guys will be down?
I think the route is cool. I think the unions are ready to go step.
Well, probably not. But they're putting barricades up now so you can get on there.
Well, but I think what you run into, because we've seen this before, back at Jennifer Granholm's last state address, the Tea Party was outside protesting. Yeah. Protest them. Even though it was the Tea Party groups that were violently attacking the students, it was the students that were attacked by the police. And I think we'll see that happen.
One of the things that really always surprised me when I went to the Tea Party event was the number of speakers would say, there are agent provocateurs in the audience.
Yes.
Be aware. And I'm a parent. It's just me with my camera.
It's a great plan.
Same
it's because it's probably you. But,
it's probably me.
It's that Bonnie lady.
That Bonnie lady again, who always shows up at with that camera. But there's a certain amount of projection that goes because they are really, really good at that.
Yes.
And I just didn't think they would claim it en masse. I'm expecting to see it happen to problem.
That's exactly what we'll see, but that'll be enough for the state police to say that the public safety is in jeopardy, and therefore they need to clear the counter-protesters. Because the unions would technically be the counter-protesters, to clear them out. So you're going to see this massive police force engaged in riotous personal campaigns to get rid of 10,000 people.
Here's what I don't understand. Governor Scott Walker was doing a lot of the same things, but I'm willing to go as far as now on our governor is. And yet, he didn't really close up that kind of violence. I mean, they did clear the Capitol once of some drummers, some drum circles, but it didn't seem to be done in a way that was particularly provocative. It just seems as though the short post that I saw was really ridiculous.
Well, you know, Peter Doherty actually drew a comparison between the militarization of the state police and the New York City police. I mean, the New York City police department really led the way. The New York City police department really led the way in the militarization of the police force and military responses to police agencies. And that, you know, Peter said, look, I see this as an individual. So I really think what Peter's saying, and I agree, is we're seeing a military response, we're seeing a safety response coming from the people. And a military response is respond with massive force to stop something else. And as a public safety force, you need to force with light force.
This is SEC Radio, but we're talking to in Madison, Michigan. And we're talking with Tom Hayward about the upcoming events of the public police response. And I can tell you, Tom, from personal experience, that we're talking about back in the 70s and early 80s, well, in the mid-80s to the early 90s, I was working with police agencies, including the New York Police Department at the time when Bill Bratton was still really trying to do the information. And what I watched over time, you become more enamored with these computerized and all too often when you give that message, what's the point of the police department to do? They do anything to say.
And I crack the heads and shooting controller. Yes.
I can tell you that one of the reasons that I left that field was the battle for the hearts and minds of the police agencies across the United States was because of the ninja power, SWAT team, militarized approach, the barrel gates with their tanks, and we bought a tank so we could push those people in the direction of the community and say, I mean, it was a racist, militarized police force. And I was so horrified by it, and so were the progressive police chiefs that I was working with. So we really tried to push back the community police and the revolutionary community. We lost big time. I mean, ever since Homeland Security was taken over, we have had a militarized domestic police force, and I think we're going to be pushing.
Well, and here's a question for you. You know the city of Lansing has a tank.
Yeah, a tank.
But is that tank
Kansas
coming out
police,
tomorrow?
Kansas police have a SWAT team.
Where are you?
Everybody has to have their own SWAT team. It's totally, it's totally ridiculous. There should be one SWAT team for a region that can do rapid response.
But what happens if it's Saturday night once?
But you have 32 deaths for every little bird.
That's right.
Yeah.
So, but I do think
that
there's a serious question. Well, but that begs the question. Bridge Brunetto, back in the March protest, said Lansing Police Department will not be involved in
this. He said it again Friday night.
But they've got the tank. The state police doesn't have the tank.
They don't have a tank.
I think they've got their own tanks, but, you know, but the Lansing Police tank is right there.
Yeah.
I don't know. I am betting, just based on the amount of street closures and whatnot that are happening, the Lansing Police Department will be engaged in this question.
What other bills, though, should we be talking about in the remaining minutes here? I have a list that we've started, and at the top there are some serious issues about civil rights issues, particularly related to adoption on a federal LGBT couple.
Well, I don't think it's just LGBT couples. I think that's really important.
Okay.
Remember, this is, right now there's legislation that's creeping its way through the legislature that will allow any adoption agency to refuse to adopt to a family, regardless of how qualified they are. Even if an agency, the child welfare agency, has said this is a fully qualified family, the adoption agency, based on their religious beliefs can say no, they play football.
It's this religious conscience idea that somehow the state is oppressing and denying people religious freedom that they have to follow the law and come to them.
Exactly.
And other issues. There's other issues coming through.
Well, we've got the medical conscience clause,
yeah,
which says that as a doctor or a pharmacist or an emergency medical technician, you don't have to provide services to a person who represents someone who are morally opposed. So if you're an evangelical Christian who believes that, you know, if you're a Muslim who is part of an antichrist, you can refuse to provide services.
Including mental health services.
Yeah. And that's actually the third one, is that there's a counseling service. By the way, did you see the Eastern Michigan University say?
No.
They agreed to pay her $75,000 for some of the kids. It just came out today. Because it was cheaper to pay her $75,000 than to the principal.
Because a counselor refused to...
Julia Ward refused to counsel a gay student while she was counseling a student at Eastern Michigan University.
Yeah.
She refused to follow the code of conduct for her profession, and they threw her out. And rightfully so. She became a big hero in the religious world. Arizona is still up
for the
$75,000. So evidently Jesus is only worth $75,000.
Minus whatever the dollar costs. There is always a percent.
Well, yeah, I'm sure.
What else is
Senator Rick Jones, I know, is pushing this medical marijuana bill where then, you know, this whole line about government trying to help the dispensaries.
Yeah.
They're going to basically try various tactics.
Help them disappear.
Help them disappear. Even though we're seeing the trend nationwide on both LGBT issues and legalization of drug issues, but the pendulum is definitely swinging to the left now. And so they're going, I think this is the sort of idea of a last gasp for the people trying to get their agenda through while they think they're not through. Michigan now, Marion College, has been very active in working with the 5711, the abortion super bill. There are also there are some strange ones going through those, but, you know, I'm not sure the current status of the one about medical votes remains. And,
that one, I believe, is actually tied by the Prosper Shield reforms.
Oh, you know, that one is very disturbing, not because of a social agenda, but because
of the cost.
Blue Cross Blue Shield wants to switch from being a nonprofit, which can be regulated, into becoming a mutual insurance company, which will have fewer oversight, less citizen oversight for rates and other issues. I'm just stunned. I mean, under normal circumstances, that one alone would be.
Well, and let's also put that in context, in the fact that, you know, right now Blue Cross Blue Shield is the insurer of last resort.
Yes.
And,
well, first resort of the
of only resort in many cases. But, you know, our legislature and their grand intelligence saw fit to vote not to create an insurance
exchange. Yes.
So not only are we eliminating the insurer of last resort, but we're also not going to have a common insurance group for which people who have these pre-existing conditions, high-risk people who are supposed to be brought into the insurance process, can get insurance. Unless it comes to the federal government. And these are people who are against federal involvement, except when they're not, I guess.
Well, the whole goal is to set up Obamacare so that there'll be a backlog that they can then try to bring in president. And as long as you leave the government to be you might want to believe that that's the case.
Side note, you saw the study about the population of having a lower IQ than Western Americans, like 20 points lower, actually.
That saved a lot of money.
Yeah, I could have told them that, but you know, we've got some other stuff coming through the legislature. By the way, 5711, I'm told, will probably come up in the Senate Thursday. That's the big, giant abortion bill.
That's the super abortion.
The super abortion bill. We're seeing some legislation, I'm not sure exactly what's at, but we'll prohibit private insurance companies from offering abortion.
Yeah, well, it will be, they will not be able to offer it except for an extra fee, and currently there is no rider that you can buy that would give you more coverage.
So, I mean, we're seeing a real assault on women's choice.
Oh, absolutely.
Just as we're seeing an assault on teen folks. I don't think that those are mutually exclusive issues.
And we're getting the contraception exemption for conscience. They feel so that your insurance, your employer can decide whether you're going to get contraception covered under your insurance. We're seeing the personal property tax exemption.
That is, I'm told again that that may come up for her about the report, and that's a big deal. If that goes, then the way we fund all of our local revenues, including libraries,
cities.
Well, the personal property tax is a tax that's charged on the equipment that different businesses have. So if you own a milling company, your milling equipment is taxed. That tax is part of what funds our local revenues.
Just as a property tax or property.
Correct. And that gets split up equally among the municipalities, and that's how we fund fire and police and libraries and social service programs and all the above. Well, the governor and the Republicans have said, you know what, let's get rid of this because it's onerous on business owners and it'll just be great. They've made some proposals on what to replace it with, but they haven't said exactly which one they're going to do. All of them have been seen by anybody with any sense of and what we're likely to see is, at the end of the day, we're going to end up losing money on the local revenue shrinks, and start seeing more and more of these municipalities shrinking and facing either merger or bankruptcy.
Well, that leads to the last two, which is the supposed education reform of the Education Authority, which amends the CEO of the way to go to privatized schools so that you won't have as many public schools to fund. And the other one is that, despite what the citizens of Michigan voted for in the last election, to get rid of the emergency manager law, we have a new one.
But it's different.
Oh.
Because you can choose which of the four punishments
right.
you get.
Right.
You know, you can either go bankrupt, or you can get an emergency financial manager, or you can have a settlement. But you could choose that.
Yeah, yeah.
Which you didn't get to do under the emergency financial.
Which
wait, yes, you did.
On the brink of having to do it.
Yes, my understanding is they've agreed with a 30-day review, which will lead you to bankruptcy or emergency financial.
I mean, it can, but I mean, that would be
utterly pathetic.
Well, and I think it's really important to recognize that if they go bankrupt, can impact clearly the entire state of Michigan.
Well, yeah.
Which is part of the reason why the governor is so worried about it. You know, this is going to put our ability to borrow the funds. A lot of the stuff that we need to do right now to improve our infrastructure. I think those three things, the personal property tax, the education reform bill, and we'll talk about that in 2 seconds, and this emergency financial manager stuff, are really dangerous things.
They are.
That are not getting the attention that the civil rights issues are, because these are complicated funding schemes, really,
yes, yes.
that the average American just doesn't get. And that's, well, and I admit, I'm one of those people, I had to take time to really read and understand how these things are. But once you understand them, and you recognize how we're rewriting them, it's the thing.
What we're seeing, really, is an assault on the middle class and on the poor, and all of the money that is quote-unquote going to be saved is really supposed to be distribution of the wealth coverage. Again, we are seeing this idea that the 1% is going to gain from this. You know, I asked the clerk in line to go to hire, and I said, are you having the clerk yet? I said, are you a full-time worker? He said, well, no. I said, because you expect to be part-time and survivable. I said, because, you know, so many of the major corporations and the small miners are really acting. I'm sure they're struggling with the thought that they don't have we see all of them, they're already been turning a lot of their workers into part-time workers. Are we going to see any part-time workers in the future?
I don't know. Those are questions that we'll have to visit after the meeting. As we start seeing things coming in place and coming.
If all of this goes through tomorrow, aren't we really engaged in what we're doing to show the other revenues for the
government? I would think that would be one way to classify it.
I'm listening, and it is unbelievable, isn't it? I mean, I feel like we're sitting here tonight on the brink of something truly lovely. Even if it's peaceful tomorrow, which I hope it is, I think we're on the brink of a real radical change in Michigan, extreme beyond what people have any
idea. I think we're sitting on the edge of a new culture. We're very rich, and we run everything up. Everyone else is rich.
Well, we'll be back next Monday night to find out what happened. We'll see if anything can be done to slow down the freight train. And thank you for listening to Lansing Online Radio, WLNZ, 89.7 here in Lansing, Michigan.